شبابا قد أنابا إلى الله استجاب.
والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الخلق والمرسلين محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. يقول المولى جل جلاله: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله ولتنظر نفس ما قدمت لغد واتقوا الله إن الله خبير بما تعملون. أيها الإخوة الكرام, the theme and the story of Musa عليه السلام and Pharaoh is a recurring one in the Quran. Why, one might ask, to teach us many lessons. And among them, Allah Azza wa Jalla is teaching us that in every era and generation, there'll be tawaghit, rulers, oppressive leaders like Pharaoh. But Allah Azza wa Jalla doesn't mention a problem, except He comes with His solution to also teach us that in every era and generation, there will rise heroes like Musa alayhi salam. And Allah Azza wa Jalla describes this most eloquently many times in the Quran, but inshallah ta'ala today we're going to focus on Surah number 28, Surah Al-Qasas. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, نَتْلُوا عَلَيْكَ مِنْ نَبَيِ مُوسَى وَفِرْعَوْنَ بِالْحَقِّ لِقَوْمِ يُؤْمِنُونَ. We narrate only some of the details here of Musa and Fir'aun, بِالْحَقِّ. We're narrating the story in truth. A lot of times people, when they tell stories, they may add some sugar and spice. Why? To make it interesting. You know, when a brother telling a story and he adds extra details that aren't true, he adds a bit of tajleed in there, you say, Akhi, please, stop spinning stuff. Allah Azza wa Jalla doesn't need to add any extra phony details to make it interesting. Allah said, but how, he'll say it in truth, give you all the facts, and that's engaging enough. لِقَوْمِ يُؤْمِنُونَ, for people who believe. Allah Azza wa Jalla here is mentioning the purpose of the stories of the Qur'an, and in particular here, Musa and Fir'aun. Because people tell stories for various purposes. As a parent, you might tell a story to your kids to put them to bed. A person might write a novel to become famous. A person might make a movie to earn big bucks at the box office. You might tell a story to your mates to entertain. Allah says, I've got higher purpose. I tell stories, لِقَوْمِ يُؤْمِنُونَ, for your iman. To make the iman rise, subhanAllah. Yes, sometimes the stories of the Qur'an will make you laugh. Sometimes they'll make you cry. But at the end of the day, the purpose is to increase us in faith. Then Allah starts the story of Musa alayhi salam and Fir'aun. He says, إِنَّ فِرْعَوْنَ عَلَى فِي الْأَرْضِ. I'm sure we're all familiar with movies and films and TV. We grew up on this stuff. Allah Azza wa Jalla starts the opening scene here of this surah with the tyrant, with the enemy, with the criminal. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, Fir'aun no doubt rose in the land. Ala fil ard. If there was a camera back then, it will show Fir'aun on top of his balcony in his castle, overlooking Egypt with the pyramids in the background, the wind blowing into his hair, looking down upon the oppressed people. They are so oppressed, they can't even look Fir'aun in the eye. That's how intimidating he is. That's what Allah Azza wa Jalla is telling us here. He rose in the land. He rose as an oppressor, as a tyrant. And what's interesting is Allah used the verb here. Allah didn't call him alim, the name. He used the verb. You may say, what's the difference between a verb and a noun in Arabic? Verbs are temporary, names are permanent. It's like you say, I went for a jog yesterday. Use the verb. I went for a jog. That doesn't mean you're necessarily going to go for a jog today or tomorrow. The verb indicates something one-off, it's temporary, as opposed to the name. If you call someone a jogger, you give them the name of jogger, it means they're always doing it. It's on a permanent basis. You teach your kid something one-off, doesn't make you a teacher. You see, a verb is temporary. But when you're constantly teaching, you're called teacher. So that's the difference between verbs and nouns. Verbs are temporary, nouns are long-lasting. Allah used the verb here to teach us His rise to power is temporary. Don't worry. Likewise today, with Assisi, the Sisi, and Bashar, all of these tyrannical tawaghit, their rise to power is temporary. So don't despair. That's what Allah Azza wa Jalla is teaching us here. وَجَعَلَ أَهْلَهَا شِيعًا. And He made its people into Shia, meaning He made them into groups, into factions, that are so concerned with one another, they're paranoid with one another, they fight amongst each other. Why? Divide and conquer. I wonder if that tactic will work with the Muslims today. Divide them into groups, pin them up against each other, this sheikh versus that sheikh, this masjid versus that masjid, this brother against that brother. I wonder if that will work with the Muslims. No, it won't work. Of course it will work. That's exactly what the enemies of Islam want from us. They want to divide us into these factions and groups. SubhanAllah. Why? So they can stay as the ruling class. وَجَعَلَ أَهْلَهَا شِيعًا. And also among his tactics, to be among the leaders of those people, يَسْتَضْعِفُ طَائِفَةً مِّنْهُمْ. Allah Azza wa Jalla, here is telling us what he used to do further. He used to weaken a particular group among them. He weakened all of the class of people, but a ta'ifa in particular, a group among them, he made them even more weaker. He subjugated them further. Who were those people? Banu Israel. يَسْتَضْعِفُ طَائِفَةً مِّنْهُمْ. He made them ضعيف, ضعفاء. He made them weak, Banu Israel. So weak, Allah Azza wa Jalla tells us what he used to do to their young infant boys. يُذَبِّحُ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ. He used to slaughter their boys. Allahu Akbar. Yani even animals. Animals, if you go after the young, they have defense mechanisms built in, they will react. They were so oppressed, weak and pathetic, they couldn't react. They couldn't do nothing. Once I was in the park with my kids, and we saw this little bird, this little creature. It looked like a half bird, half duck. I don't know what it was. It looked cute though. We went over to it. Oh, mashallah, look at this little bird. As we got closer, my kids and I, it started to go off at us. Rah, rah, rah. What's going on here? It was protecting its young. SubhanAllah, protecting its babies. And my kid, my son, is 5 years old. If he wants, he can step on it with one foot, it'll go splat. It knows it's got no chance against us. But why is it doing it? To protect its young. Banu Israel was so weak, they couldn't do nothing. They couldn't do a thing. They couldn't react, just like what's happening overseas today. I believe in brothers and sisters are being bombed, terrorized, their kids are being taken from them. Unfortunately, in many cases, we can't do a thing. Allah is really showing us how weak they were, teaching us perhaps we might be in that weakness one day, SubhanAllah. But don't worry, the solution's coming. يُذَبِّحُ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ وَيَسْتَحْيِ نِسَاءَهُمْ. They'll keep their women alive. Why? Why keep the women alive? To produce more babies. What a sicko Fir'aun was. He kept the women alive to produce more babies, and then he can kill them off whenever he wants, SubhanAllah. Then Allah adds, إِنَّهُ كَانَ مِنَ الْمُفْسِدِينَ. Only a true mufsid, a true corrupter in the land will do this. Allah described him as one of the mufsidin, the corruptors, SubhanAllah. And Allah gave him the name here, the title. We said difference between verbs and names. Names are permanent. This was his job. A 9-to-5 on a permanent basis. If Fir'aun had an office, on the front of that office door, it would say Mufsid, corrupter. SubhanAllah, innahu. No doubt, Fir'aun was among the oppressors, among the corruptors in the land. And then Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned his intentions. See, Fir'aun had a plan, but Allah had a bigger one. وَنُرِيدُ أَنَّهُنَّ عَلَى الَّذِينَ اسْتُضْعِفُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ. Allah said, not we wanted, we want. What's the difference? Want is past tense, it's a one-off. Allah said, we want continuously in every era, in every generation, we wanted to bless those, to favor those who were oppressed in the land. Allah used the mudara sense of the word in Arabic. The mudara in Arabic is the present future tense form of the word. And the difference between the present future tense from the past tense is that the past tense is a one-off. You can't use past tense verbs to talk about the present or the future. You say, I ate. Past tense. You can't say I ate now or I'm eating now. If you want to say eating now, use eating, and use for the future, I'll be eating out tomorrow. The point is, present tense verbs indicate future tense. Eating now, eating tomorrow. Ate is past tense. Allah used the present tense form of the word to teach us that He wants now, and He also wants this continuously in the future to bless those that were weakened in the land. In our case, us, this ummah. وَنُرِيدُ أَنَّهُنَّ عَلَى الَّذِينَ اسْتُضْعِفُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ. وَنَجْعَلَهُمْ أَئِمَّةً. And on top of that, how is Allah going to bless these people? Allah said He wants to make them أَئِمَّةً, the plural of imam. He wants to make them leaders. He said, how are these oppressed people going to be leaders when Fir'aun and Haman and his army are leaders? Conflict of interest. They're not going to allow them to become leaders. So what does Allah add? وَنَجْعَلَهُمْ الْوَارِثِينَ. And we want to make these oppressed people, Banu Israel, the inheritors. When do you hear the word inheritors, inheritance? When someone dies, what is Allah telling us? What does He want to do to Fir'aun and his army? He wants to kill them off. He wants to make them inheritors of Fir'aun, subhanAllah. What are they going to inherit? the land and the kingdom. Allahu Akbar. Even if we don't see the means as something possible, even if the results seem impossible, if Allah wants it, He will make it happen. That's what Allah Azza wa Jalla is telling us here. وَنَجْعَلَهُمُ الْوَرِثِينَ. Then Allah adds, وَنُمَكِّنَ لَهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. The first thing Allah wants for them, He wants to stabilize them in the land. Now let's just say Fir'aun miraculously gets destroyed and his empire, they become leaders. How are they going to run a government? They've got no experience. You know, pose this to world analysts today. We say occupied Palestine, they call it Israel, we call it occupied Palestine. The believers, they're going to take over. And those occupiers, their enemies, they're going to be destroyed, they're going to be finished off. And then those people who were occupied, they're going to take over and run a successful government. That's impossible. Even if that does happen by chance, they've got no experience. And if you own a business, and you say to your kid, look, tomorrow you're taking over, he'll run that business to the ground. It won't succeed. No experience. Allah is saying that He will make them stable. Even though they've got no experience, it seems impossible, Allah will make it happen. Allah makes the impossible possible. And then Allah adds beautifully, وَنُرِيَ فِرْعَوْنَ وَهَامَانَ وَجُنُودَهُمَا مِنْهُمْ مَا كَانُوا يَحْذَرُونَ. And on top of this, all of these blessings, it's one thing for Fir'aun to be destroyed. Allah said, وَنُرِيَ. We're going to show Fir'aun and Haman, his general, and his soldiers, the army, we're going to show them. We're going to show them their defeat before they are taken. SubhanAllah, that's worse. And it's one thing for your enemy to defeat you, but it's another when you see your enemy take over your land, your property, and then they kill you. That's even worse. He's going to see with his own eyes Banu Israel rise. He's going to see with his own eyes, subhanAllah. Then Allah adds, not just they're going to rise, what they fear. Allah said He's going to show Fir'aun and Haman and his soldiers, and Haman was the governor general. He's going to show them what they fear. What is Allah telling us here? He's telling us that deep down in their hearts, these oppressors fear the oppressed, wallahi. These people, they fear the people that they are oppressing. That's why they are oppressing them. Because they know if these people come to power, it's all over for us. They know Islam, wallahi, will eliminate oppression. Oppression that their own hands are causing. What an opening to Surah Al-Qasas. And then Allah Azza wa Jalla does something that you won't expect. You're reading these ayat, Allah Azza wa Jalla is telling you that there's this oppressor, a king in the land. He's got power, so much power that people can't even look him in the eye. They can't even react when their kids are taken from them. They can't do a thing. But among them a hero shall rise. And there's going to be war. There's going to be bloodshed. This empire is going to crumble. You're reading on, you're thinking, Allahu Akbar, this story is getting interesting. What happens next? You're expecting jihad, you're expecting a fight, you're expecting the action. Allah Azza wa Jalla switches the whole scene of this surah to وَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَىٰ أُمِّ مُوسَىٰ أَنْ أَرْضِعِي. We inspire the mother of Musa, give the baby milk. You're thinking, what just happened here? I was expecting war, I was expecting Musa to come and fight Fir'aun, I was expecting something, I was expecting action. It's like the movie just went to this scene, a little hut with a woman with a child breastfeeding a kid. You're like, what's going on here? What Allah Azza wa Jalla just did here is what they call today in modern film and cinema, monologues. In modern film, this is a technique today. They'll use the opening scene of a movie as the last scene. They use the last scene of the movie as the opening scene. They actually show you in the beginning of the movie, or the beginning of the novel, or the beginning of the show, what's actually going to happen in the end. SubhanAllah, it's a very creative way of writing a story or a novel or a movie. It's not something new though. This is done and more to perfection in the Qur'an. Allah Azza wa Jalla showed you what's going to happen in the end, then He takes you back. It's as if the screen goes black and then you see 30 years ago. And it goes back to Musa alayhi salam as a kid. So what's the connection? What's a kid got to do with the empire Fir'aun crumbling? Because this is the kid who's going to be the hero in the future. Another lesson that you may see. This kid, he's going to be the means of Fir'aun's demise. He's going to make Banu Israel rise. Yes. Teaching us, even if something seemed impossible, with Allah Azza wa Jalla, He can make it happen. Never underestimate the divine decree of Allah Azza wa Jalla. And that's what we've learned recently in Ashura. We fasted the day of Ashura. Why? To commemorate the day that Allah Azza wa Jalla sent Musa and Banu Israel from Fir'aun. So this teaches us yearly, year in and year out, constantly to remind us that just as Fir'aun yesterday faced a humiliating end, the pharaohs of today will also face a humiliating end. And with the rise of every Pharaoh that comes in Musa, and with the rise of every Abu Jahl comes in Abu Bakr, and with the rise of every Dajjal comes in Masih, and with the rise of every Jalut comes in Dawud, we ask Allah Azza wa Jal to grant this Ummah victory sooner rather than later. Ameen. أقول هذا القول وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وبعد. Brothers, please try and move forward as much as possible to make room for your brethren and fellow. This Ummah will be granted victories over the years, but that doesn't mean we won't suffer any defeats. Yes, we will lose battles, but in the end we'll win the war. And this was no different in the time of the Prophet ﷺ. And arguably the worst defeat this Ummah has ever faced, arguably, is the defeat at Uhud. Yes, there was a defeat in terms of dunya. In terms of deen, of course, a Muslim is defeated, he is killed, he's a shaheed, no doubt. In terms of dunya, this was one of the worst defeats. You say, Akhi Bizri, how could you say it was one of the worst defeats? I say that because this was a defeat in which Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Rasul of this Ummah, was almost killed. And for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to die, that's the biggest calamity that this Ummah could face, as he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself told us. So it was a battle in which he almost got killed alayhi salatu wa sallam. Yet after that defeat, after the spiritual low, after the Sahaba were demoralized, what did Allah Azza wa Jal reveal in Surah Ali Imran? وَلَا تَهِنُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا وَأَنْتُمْ الْأَعْلَوْنَ إِن كُنْتُمْ مُؤْمِنِينَ. Don't despair, don't fall into grief, don't fall into sorrow. Don't worry, bro. Allah Azza wa Jal is saying, you are superior if you are the true believers. When did Allah reveal this ayah, my dear brethren? After the victory at Badr, after the conquest of Mecca, after the Muslims conquered 3/4 of the globe? No, Allah revealed this ayah, you are superior after we were defeated. Look at the irony. Allah is teaching us here, between the lines, no matter what happened to this Ummah, no matter what, if we are defeated in war, if our brothers are being imprisoned unjustly, if our women are being raped, if our countries are being bombed, if our kids are being taken from us, if our resources are being usurped, we are always superior. You know why? Because we have something the enemies of Islam and the Muslims will never have. And that is Islam. Islam, that's what we have that they don't. In kuntum mu'mineen, iman. Iman. Because the one who has Allah has everything. If Allah is all that you have, wallahi is all that you need. The one who kneels before Allah can stand before anyone and anything. Put Allah first, and wallahi you'll never be last. That's what Allah is teaching us. Today, what do we hear from the believers? Whenever they're going to be granted victory, cuz. Victory is far away, bro. Look at our Ummah, it's so weak, it's so pathetic. What did we just mention in Surah Al-Qasas? Even if our people are so weak, so oppressed, so pathetic, if Allah wills for them to rise, they will rise. If Allah wills that a young infant be taken by the tyrannical Firaun himself and raised as a prince, if Allah wants that, it will happen. Even if the means seem impossible, plant the seed, Allah will make it grow. Allah's not going to ask us about the outcome. He's going to ask us about what we've done. We just plant the seed. We just play our part. Never underestimate anything that we can do for Islam. Whether it's $1 or $2, let's say it's only $1. Whether it's signing a petition, doing something, wallahi, if we all play our part, we can make the Ummah great. Wallahi, we can. Because a mountain is made up of small pebbles. Pebble here, pebble there. Small efforts, they amount to something large. Oceans are made up of drops of water. Vast deserts are made up of grains of sand. And Allah is teaching us also here, when the Ummah is facing trialing times, what do? Would it be negative? This is when we give glad tidings. Now, to what's happening to the Ummah, locally and globally, this is when we give the glad tidings. No matter what's happening to the Ummah, we say, Abshiru. We receive the glad tidings from Allah Azza wa Jalla and His Messenger here, from the Quran, of course, from the Seerah. This is what the Battle of Uhud teaches us. And I'll mention one more example in here. And that was the Battle of Al-Ahzab. The Battle of Al-Ahzab is also called the Battle of the Trench, which we'll explain why. Why was it called the Battle of Al-Ahzab? Firstly, the word Ahzab is plural for Hizb. Hizb means a jama'ah, a group, a party of people. So it was parties, groups of the kuffar, enemies in multitudes, came together, united, to fight the Muslims. That's why it's called Ahzab. The battle of the Confederates, the battle of the armies. The Muslims were only 3,000 in number. They were up against 10,000 of the Kuffar. The Jews, the Quraysh, the Arab tribes of Qatafan, and Banu Asad and others, they all came together. 10,000 of them. Never ever. Before this, in the seerah of Rasulullah did 10,000 of the Kuffar come to fight the Muslims. You see why it's called Ahzab? They came in groups, but there's another reason. The word Hazaba in Arabic means to afflict you with worry, to cause you great trauma and distress. That's what the hadith says. إِذَا حَزَبَهُ أَمْرٌ أَيْ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمْ رَجَعَ إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ. When a matter would afflict Rasulullah, when he'd be worried about something, صلى الله عليه وسلم, something that would cause him distress, he would return, go back to the salah. So the word hazaba means to afflict you with trauma, distress, because Allah could have called it the battle of the jama'at. That's another way of saying groups. But Allah is teaching us here, it wasn't just groups of the kuffar, but it was something that was great stress and trauma for the believers. And to further indicate this, how stressful this battle was. The Sahaba said we had no food, hardly any water. We'd have to eat rotten animal fat that would stick to our throats and produce a foul stench. And we would sleep with our arms. They would sleep with their weapons. Allahu Akbar, that's how terrified they were. Imagine sleeping with a pistol beneath your pillow. You don't know if someone's going to kill you or you're going to kill yourself. That's how terrifying it was. They said, we fear even going to the toilet. They feared relieving themselves. No one wanted to go, thinking the enemy will ambush them. On top of this, Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu says, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stood up one day and he asked us, who will volunteer to go and get intel, information from the kuffar? Who? No one volunteered, not a single companion. These mountains of Sahaba, they were terrified. The likes of Abu Bakr and Umar, they were there, no one volunteered. You see why it was called Ahzab? Not because of just groups, but great trauma and distress for the Muslims. To make matters worse, when they were digging the trench, why were they digging a trench? They were digging a trench to protect Al-Madinah. This is something that Salman al-Farisi suggested to the Prophet. He was Persian. He said, Ya Rasulullah, this is something we used to do back home. How about we do it here to protect Al-Madinah? The Prophet, what does he do? He said, who are you, bro? I'm the man in charge here. No, he accepts this advice on board. What a humble man, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's the Rasul and Prophet of this Ummah, yet he lends an attentive ear to his companions, to his friends. That's a true leader. Not a person who's just domineering and gives orders and becomes a dictator. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam accepts this nasiha. They start to dig a trench around Al-Madinah. Showing us also that the kuffar were constantly attacking. If one was to read the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when the believers migrated to Al-Madinah, what did the kuffar do? What did the enemies do? Oh, alhamdulillah, bidum waj'aras. Khalas, we're done with these Muslims now. No more headache. No. They kept on attacking. They came to fight at Badr. They came to fight at Uhud. They came to fight at the Battle of Ahzab and the Battle of the Trench. They. Teaching us shabab, the enemies of Islam, if you leave them alone, they won't leave you alone. They won't. They're coming to attack once again. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba, digging this trench, they hit a boulder, huge rock, no one can penetrate. It was breaking the axes of the companions. So who comes along? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the man. He's the one that's going to take care of this boulder. He comes with his axe and he says, Bismillah, and he strikes it. It cracks, light comes out. The Prophet makes takbir. He strikes it again. It cracks, light comes out. He makes a second takbir. He strikes it for a third time. It cracks, light comes out. Third takbir, and then it turns to dust. And all the Sahaba erupt in takbirat. Allahu Akbar! Allahu Akbar! Salman al-Farisi witnessed this amazing scene. He said, Ya Rasulullah, all this light, all the takbirat for? The Prophet ﷺ said, when this light came out, Allah showed me that we are going to conquer Rome. Allah gave me the glad tidings right there and there, until I could see the white palaces before my very eyes. On the second crack of that rock, Allah showed me that we are going to conquer Persia, until I could see the red palaces before my eyes. And on the third crack, Allah showed me that we are going to conquer Yemen, and I could see the gates of Sana'a open before my very eyes to this Ummah. When did Rasulullah ﷺ give these glad tidings? When the Muslims were high and mighty, superior? No, he gave those glad tidings when the Ummah was in the pits. The Sahaba feet going to the toilet. That's how dire the situation was. Likewise today, ya ikhwah, we give the glad tidings. times to this ummah, no matter what's happening overseas, this ummah wallahi will be given victory by Allah. Now's the time to give the glad tidings. Now's not a time to fall into despair. Right now we give the glad tidings. We have to be positive. Have trust in the faith of Allah, in the tawakkul, in the promise of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Right now. You can't lead a positive life with a negative mind. It's not going to happen. We need to be positive. And finally, after the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, what was this treaty all about? The Prophet ﷺ receives wahi from Allah. He sees a dream in which he and the Sahaba are performing Umrah. So they go, 1400 of them, to perform Umrah into Mecca. They are denied by the Kuffar. Cut a long story short, the Kuffar was successful in turning the Muslims back. Rasulullah ﷺ from performing Umrah. What's amazing is that in the history of Quraysh, they never ever prevented anyone from performing Umrah and Hajj ever. Except the Muslims, subhanAllah. You know why? We're the exception? Because we are the exception. We're special. We're the exception. We're the only religion of At-Tawheed. Only. So when the Muslims went back, the Kuffar were delighted. They were delighted. They said, Alhamdulillah, al-Khalas, no more Muslims. Let them go back. Allah revealed, Inna fatahna laka fatha mubina. Allah revealed Surah Al-Fatih in its entirety when the Sahaba returned to Hudaybiyah. Allah is saying, we opened for you a clear manifest opening, a clear victory. What's fatah? In Arabic, fatah means to open. And in jihad, it's used to open a land. Right? Because land is locked. You can't just walk into a country or a city and say, we're taking over. No, it's locked. That territory is locked. So fatah is used when you open a land through victory. While nas in Arabic is used for victory alone. So the point is, nas, victory, fat is when you conquer land. That's why we say, Nusilna fi Badr. We will get victory at Badr. You don't say, Fatah Badr. There was no land that we conquered in Badr. The point is, fat is used for conquering land. Allah said, we've just given you a clear fat. You say, how can it be fat when there was no land at Hudaybiyah that the Muslims conquered? Because Allah Azza wa Jal, He made this fat the Fatah of Mecca. The Fatah Mecca, this led to the opening of Mecca. That's how great it was. What's the point? Why am I saying this? Because at the time, the Kuffar were pleased. The spirits of the Sahaba were low. They thought, what happened? It's a calamity. But the misfortunes of the believer are fortunes in disguise. They were happy. They were happy, subhanAllah. They thought, oh, you know, we turned the Muslims back. But 2 years later, the Muslims come with 10,000 strong and take over Mecca. Allahu Akbar. The point is, never despair of the divine decree of Allah. Victory is coming and victory is near. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to grant this ummah victory and to keep the believers steadfast up until their final breath. Ameen. Allahumma a'azza al-Islam wal-Muslimin. Allahumma a'azza al-Islam wal-Muslimin. Wa adilla al-shirka wal-Mushrikeen. Wa dammir a'da' al-Din. Wa ahmi hawzata al-Islam ya Rabbal Alameen. Allahumma ansur deenak wa kitabak wa sunnata nabiyyik. وعبادك الموحدين اللهم فك قيد أسرانا وأسرى المسلمين وردهم إلى أهلهم سالمين إنهم في حاجة عاجلة إلى رحماتك وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين وأقم
الصلاة يا شبابا قد أنابا وإلى الله استجابا إن من يرجو الثواب ليباري بالصعاب